Des Moines, and all of central Iowa, welcome to Max World Live. Max World is your world. Every day we talk about the issues and topics that matter most to you. And as always, it's your voice we want to hear in Max World. So join the conversation by calling 515-244-0077. And now, here's the host of Max World Live, J. Michael McCoy.
All right, good afternoon. 6 minutes after the hour, 4 o'clock. 23rd day of October in the Lord's year 2015. I'm J. Michael McCoy, and welcome to Max World on a Friday. Sure appreciate you being here. Got a lot of stuff going on over the weekend. The weather's kind of changing around here. I think we're permanently into fall now. Speaking of weather and weather people, I don't know if you're aware of this, but John McLaughlin, who's a follower, a great guy, he's your weather guy on Channel 8. He has a very serious illness, which has kept him off TV, on and off TV over the last few months. He's now taking a sabbatical from Channel 8 through the end of the year to try to get this illness healed. And it is a respiratory illness. And of course, if you're a weather guy, a radio guy, a TV guy, a talk guy, having a respiratory illness is not a very good thing. It's kind of like a quarterback having a broken arm or a hockey player having teeth. I don't know. It's just serious. And so please, on your prayer list, put John McLaughlin from Channel 8 and pray that he gets well. And on the other side, let's go over to the other side of the television. On Channel 13, our own Erin Kiernan and her husband, local Democratic strategist Michael Kiernan, had a little baby boy on Wednesday. He came a little early. In fact, they were not expecting a boy. They were expecting a girl. Now, you would think with all the stuff that we have nowadays, 3D this and sonogram and ultras, that they could have figured out it was a boy. But for whatever reason, it was kept a mystery. And they were so surprised when the doctor said it's a boy, they had not even prepared a name. So what was the name you suggested for him?
Zerubbabel.
Zerubbabel. Mm-hmm. That sounds like something. That's like Barney Rubble's cousin.
Something like that. He could have been. But he was a prophet back in the Old Testament.
Yeah, and if you want to know where it is, Joel King found it for it. It's in Haggai 1:1.
You got it.
And can you spell that?
Zerubbabel? Zerubbabel? I don't know.
That's close.
Two B's. Three B's.
Three B's?
Oh, yeah, way more B's.
Zerubbabel.
You know, I'll bet you if that was on Wheel of Fortune, Bible prophets, I bet they'd never get that.
Nope.
They'd never be able to spell that. Frank, what are you doing?
Was this guy any relation to Barney Rubble?
He could have been.
He could have been.
He could have been. Without a doubt, he could have been. All right. Here's what we're going to do a little talking about today. We're going to talk about Luke. The chapter is 23, and the verse is 34. And you'll know this as the very famous, as Jesus hangs on the cross, his body has been beaten. It has been absolutely gone through more than any human person should ever have to go through. Taking his last breaths, Jesus looked up and said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." And the soldiers gambled for his clothes by throwing dice. The crowd watched and the leaders scoffed. "He saved others," they said. "Let him save himself if he is really God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers mocked him, too, by offering him a drink of sour wine. They called out to him, "If you are the king of the Jews, then save yourself." A sign was fastened above him with these words, "This is the king of the Jews." But the other criminals protested, "Don't you even fear God enough to know you have sentenced him to die? We deserve to die for our crimes," says one of the men on the cross. "But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into my kingdom." And Jesus, looking at the thief hanging on the cross, said, "I assure you, today you will be in paradise with me." Our guest today is Pastor Dave Harper with the YMCA. He's the chaplain for all the Ys. We'll talk about the Ys a little later. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Perhaps one of the most powerful last words said on the cross. Why did Jesus ask his Father to forgive them?
I think you've got to first ask, is he asking them to forgive them in general or asking them just to forgive them for what they are doing to him right then?
So you're saying perhaps this was the beginning of grace.
Well, no, I think grace had always been around, but I think it was the ultimate demonstration of God's grace. That even, I mean, this is where you're saying the world is basically saying, we don't want you at all, God.
Yeah.
And God still says, I'm willing to forgive you.
This is where ultimate love met ultimate hate. Ultimate love met ultimate brutality. And there was a lot of witnesses watching this. God the Father was watching this. The angels were watching this. The potential other worlds were watching this. They was watching Satan on display committing this terrible act of brutality against the Son of God. So I think what Christ was saying here is he was saying, God the Father, please don't become so incensed that you wipe out your creation
again, much
like you did with the flood.
Mm-hmm.
Spare this people because there's till the wheat and the chaff is separated. Because there's people here worth saving. Mm-hmm. So don't wipe out creation in one swoop because of what they're doing to me.
Yep.
You know, I always said, and if we look up in Revelation and we look at heaven in a biblical sense, I won't be able to do this, but I've always said that if I got to choose my job past St. Peter's Gate, I'd do a radio show in heaven. And yes, I'd want to interview the you know, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, and I'd want to interview Isaiah. He's my favorite prophet. And obviously Paul. Paul I'd do a lengthy interview on for like 8 years. But here's the other people I wanted to interview. Those that were standing there scoffing All right. at Christ. Those people that stood in that square with Pilate and said, crucify him, crucify him. Now, knowing what they know, would they have done the same?
You may get that opportunity.
Well, here's the question then. Are they in heaven?
Well, according to Revelation 1:7, if you want to look that up.
See why I call him the verse?
Starting with 6, to him that loves us, this is John the Revelator, John the Beloved, to him that loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priest to his God and Father, and to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him.
Hmm. Now, does that mean he's in heaven? Or, I'm sorry, does that mean they're in heaven?
No.
Or will they be able to see it from hell?
I don't think so, because I think in Acts 2, the same people are there in Acts 2. When Peter preaches to him and says, you crucified him. And they finally cried out, men and brethren, what do we do? And he said, you have to repent and be baptized in the name of.
And the rest of the verse yeah. says, and all the tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. So I believe there's a special resurrection at Christ's coming, of the wicked, those who pierced him so that they every eye will see him come, but there's a special group who he promised. Now, call this vengeance, call this whatever you want, but he wants those people who nailed him to that cross, Herod, Pilate, Caiaphas, Ananias, those individuals are going to see him come in the clouds of glory.
And they're going to kneel. But a lot of those in the crowd eventually were forgiven later on.
Through Acts?
Yes.
Okay.
And became part of that Jerusalem church.
Okay.
I mean, they were he said, you were the ones who did this. By the hands of the godless men, you gave him over. And so Pilate and Herod and those guys, yeah, they're going to be sitting there kneeling before him going, I can't believe I did this.
Christ had some friends on the Sanhedrin. Namely, Nicodemus mm-hmm. was one. And I believe Nicodemus eventually became a disciple of Christ.
Mm-hmm. No, I'll agree.
All right, so then here's a question I'll ask you before we take the next break. Did he forgive Judas? Because Judas obviously was crazy upset that he had done what he did. He threw the blood money back at them. The whole concept of him hanging himself was in repentance, wasn't it?
Well, let me ask you a question, Mac. What we talked about the other day, was he sorry because he was truly sorry, or was he sorry because he had gotten caught?
And to me, just because I say I forgive you doesn't necessarily mean you have accepted that forgiveness. And I think that's the key that we miss a lot of times in all of this. God offers this forgiveness to everyone out there. But what we lose sight of the fact is there has to be an acceptance of that. There has to be a repentance that says, I want that. I need that. It's more than just, you know, oh, thank you, God, for giving me this. But it's recognizing what I've done. So did he forgive Judas? Yeah, I think Jesus forgave Judas. But it's another question of, was Judas forgiven?
Did Judas repent?
Yeah. I don't think his act of hanging was an act of repentance. He knew what repentance was, what Jesus would have meant by real repentance.
He knew that he had to eat of the body of Christ and drink of the blood,
exactly,
or there was
right.
no life in him.
Yes.
He was told that expressly.
Yeah. No, I
right.
agree with that.
We're going to take our next break, and when we come back, I'm going to introduce you to two lovely young ladies. They're twins. They came here from Singapore, and we're going to talk to them how they love living in Des Moines. I'll introduce you to Andrea and Andrea. And then later on, Pastor Harper, you're going to get it. It's Ask the Pastor Questions.
Ooh,
these
cool.
are the tough ones. We're coming back live here on The Truth. Yep, 99.3.
Credit cards are like grandkids. They love you, sometimes get out of control, and it's fun to get a new one. Who can stop them from piling on?
Hi, I'm Tom Coates with Consumer Credit of Des Moines. At the end of the day, you can give these grandkids back, but you're stuck paying off bad credit card debt. We can help you put the fun back into using credit cards responsibly. Right, kids?
Yeah!
If you need help getting credit cards off your back, call Consumer Credit of Des Moines.
Whether you're 10, 25, 50, 80 years old and beyond, everyone needs to live within their means. I'm Tom Coates with Consumer Credit of America. For almost a quarter of a century, we've helped people of all ages learn to manage their personal finances to benefit them far into the future. When problems arise, we've got the experience you need to make those debt problems go away. Got financial problems? Call Consumer Credit of America.
If Tom Coates from Consumer Credit of America was your personal webmaster, Tom would filter out all bad debt emails. If Tom was your mailman, you'd never get any debt reduction junk mail. If Tom Coates was a lineman, he'd block any phone calls offering to reduce your credit card debt.
Hi, I'm Tom Coates with Consumer Credit of America, and we're still your best choice for credit counseling.
We're local, we're accountable, and we can do more. You make the call when the time's right for you.
When it comes to competition, there really is none for Consumer Credit of America.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concepts Studios, this is Webcast One Live.
Welcome right, welcome back. Max World, 21 minutes after 4 o'clock. 23rd day of October, and a very, very, very special man in my life, Rob Spearman, stopped by today with his new family. Rob and these two young ladies' mother got married and moved here to Iowa. And you guys are from Singapore.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
And your name is Andrea.
No,
you're Andrea.
Yes.
And you're Andrea.
Yes.
Now, does that mean something different in your cultural language? Because isn't that the same name? It's not the same name to you.
It's not the same name.
It's not the same name. Okay. So you're twins.
Yes.
And you're how old?
12.
Okay. And is this the first time you've ever been to America?
Yes.
Okay. So before you got here, what was your impressions from America? Was it from television? Was it from movies? Was it from books? Was it, what did you know about America?
Nothing.
Nothing.
Nothing. Not much.
Not much. Had you ever seen an American movie?
Yes.
Okay. What was your favorite American movie?
Not sure.
Not sure? How about you?
No, not sure.
How about television? Did you watch American television?
No.
No? No?
The Walking Dead.
The Walking Dead.
Yes.
Okay. And so what was the first thing when you got over here that you said, oh, that's a lot cooler than I thought it would be? Was it the cars? Was it the food? Was it television? What was it? You remember one of the first wow things you saw?
It's not very crowded.
It's not very crowded.
Yeah.
Because it was crowded where you came from, right?
Yes.
You had a lot of bicycles in Singapore, no?
Not really.
Okay, so you had automobiles?
Yes.
Cars?
Yeah, we do.
Okay. Did you have American cars? Fords, Chevys, things like that? Or what kind of cars? Well, you're girls. You probably don't know what cars. You don't care about cars, right? How about shopping malls? Did you have shopping malls?
Yeah, we have.
Okay, did you have ones better than we have here?
Yes.
Yeah? Pretty yes. Cool. What was your favorite store at the shopping mall in Singapore?
The Paper Stone.
Who?
The Paper Stone. The Paper Stone.
The Pepe store?
Paper.
Paper.
Yes. The Paper Stone.
And what did they sell?
Stationeries.
Oh, paper.
Yeah.
Oh, paper store. Okay. Is that kind of like a bookstore?
Yes. Something. It's a stationery store.
Okay. So, what's your favorite American TV show? I'll ask Andrea first.
I don't watch television.
You don't watch television?
No. Same.
You don't watch television? How come? Are you not allowed to?
No, we just don't care.
Just don't care?
Yeah.
Good for you. Good for you. Glad to hear that. How about favorite food that you never had before but you're having now?
Burrito.
Bread dough?
Burrito.
Burritos. Bean burritos. What's your favorite burrito place? You know? Or just wherever you go, you like their burritos.
Yeah.
How about you, Andrea?
I like tacos.
Tacos.
Yeah.
So you like tacos and you like burritos.
Yes.
So you both can go to a Mexican restaurant and be happy. Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
What is the yuckiest food that somebody tried to get you to try and you said, I'll never eat that again?
Beef jerky.
Beef jerky.
Yes.
Okay. How about you? Same with you?
Same.
Okay. So are you guys going to public school?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. How is our school different than your school? Back in Singapore.
Well, in Singapore, we wear uniforms, and here we can just wear.
Okay, so in Singapore, you wore uniforms, and here you can just dress regular. Yes. Do you like the regular dress or the uniform dress?
Well, I like both.
You like both?
Yep.
Okay, how about you?
I like both, too.
Okay, what's your favorite subject in school?
I like all subjects.
Do you? Do you like school?
I like school.
How about you?
Same.
You love school?
Yes.
Okay. And who's your favorite teacher?
Miss Nelson.
Miss Larson?
Miss Nelson.
Miss Nelson?
Yes.
And you?
Mrs. Whoopsa.
Mrs. Whoopsa?
Yes.
Okay. Did I say that name right? Whoopsa? Okay. So what do you think us Americans should do without? You just can't figure out why we have this or why we do this. And you just think, why do Americans do this? Why did they? Why? Have you found anything like that? You think it's just ridiculous?
Yes.
What?
Vulgarities.
What?
Vulgarities.
Say it again.
Vulgarities.
Vulgarities.
Yes.
You don't understand why we swear.
Yes.
Yeah. Why do we swear?
I don't understand that.
Do you know why we swear?
No.
Because we're lazy.
Oh.
Seriously. It's because we're too lazy to come up with the right words to communicate. And so we say vulgar words, and in return, you go, oh, I don't want to listen to that person anymore. Right? Who wants to listen to somebody who swears all the time? Am I getting that right? Is that what you meant by vulgarities?
Yes.
Okay. How about you? Mm. You just can't figure out why we do this.
Same as her.
Huh?
Same as Andra.
Okay. So did you have a pet?
Yes.
At home in Singapore?
Yes.
Yes.
What did you have?
Terrapin.
Terrapin?
Yeah.
What?
Turtle.
Turtle.
Mm.
Turtle. You had turtles?
Yeah.
Really? Okay. Mm. Did you bring them with you?
No.
Oh, no. They couldn't swim that far?
They couldn't.
They couldn't? So do you have a pet now?
Yes.
What do you have now?
A cat.
A cat? Mm. What's the cat's name?
Tinkers.
What?
Tinkers.
Thinkers?
Yes.
And who named the cat?
My dad.
Okay. And did you have the cat before? All right, so this was Dad's cat. Mm-hmm. And did the cat like you? I mean, do you like hanging around with a cat?
Yes.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
You know what you should really get, don't you? A dog. Do you like dogs?
Yes.
You should have seen the smiles in this room when I said dog. Dad, what are you shaking your head for? No dogs? No? Okay, well. Huh? Yeah, I tell you what, ladies. I'll take you to the Animal Rescue League. You know what that is?
Yeah,
that's the puppy store. And I'll get you each a puppy. And you can take it home to Dad. And I promise you, Dad will put up with it. Right, Dad? No. Okay, so I'm talking with two young ladies, Andrea and Andrea. They are 12 years old. They are twins. They and their mother just moved here from Singapore in this last year. Their mom fell in love with a local businessman here in town. And he, I can tell you're just beaming. You really like this, don't you? Yeah. Now, what do you think of little Robbie? Is that what you call him?
No. No, we call him Dad.
You call him what?
Dad.
No, not Dad. Dad's son.
Oh.
What do you call him?
Robbie.
Robbie?
Mm-hmm.
Do you like him?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. Does he treat you nice?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, good. Because if not, you let me know. I'll come. Man, David, we'll come and get him. We'll come and get him. So, you don't watch TV. What's your favorite restaurant? Anything Mexican? Burritos? Tacos? No? You have something else you like in Des Moines? Have you been to the Manhattan Deli yet?
No.
No?
No, not yet.
Went to Zombie Burgers. Yeah. Did you like those?
Yes.
Yes.
Now, do you like American music?
Yes.
Yes.
Who's your favorite artist?
I don't have one.
You don't have a favorite one?
Yes.
Do you like Taylor Swift? You don't know who that is?
I know who she, but...
Not really?
Not really.
You're not really a country girl, are you? Are you kind of a rock and roll girl?
No.
No. No. So you like... I'm so bad at this. I don't know. Lady Gaga.
No.
No? Madonna.
No.
No?
What?
Mumford and Sons?
No.
I've never heard of them either. All right.
Korean pop.
Korean?
Pop.
Pop.
Yes.
Is that an artist?
No.
That's a type of music?
Yes.
Korean pop. So is that like American pop music? Is that like our top 40? A little bit different? Korean hip hop. Can you sing some of the words to your favorite Korean hip hop song?
No.
No, you can't? Okay. All right. So what haven't you done yet that you're looking forward to doing?
Basketball games.
You haven't been to a basketball game yet?
No.
Okay, good. How about you, young lady? Have you been to a football game yet?
Yes.
Did you like it?
Yes. It's really fun.
Really fun. Do you like basketball too?
Yes.
Yes. What sport don't you like?
I love all sports.
You love all sports. Do you play any sports?
Yes.
What do you play?
I do track and field.
Track and field?
Yes.
And do you run?
Yes.
Do you throw the shot put?
No.
No, it's too heavy. It's too heavy for me too. Yeah, that's not really. So now, Dad, you just shut your ears. I'm going to talk to your daughters here for a second. So how about American boys? Are they cute?
All right.
They're just all right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Singapore boys are cuter?
I don't know.
You don't know?
They're just the same.
The same? Yeah. You know what I always taught my daughters to say about boys? Icky boys. Boys are icky. Stay away from boys. But you have a boyfriend already, right?
No.
You
no.
don't? I no. heard you did.
No.
How about you?
No.
No, you don't have a boyfriend?
No.
Does she have a boyfriend?
No.
You tell me if it was true, right?
She doesn't have a boyfriend.
Oh, okay. But you'll tell me when she does.
Okay.
You'll call me up and tell me. Okay, I'll give you a 6-page business card when we're done. Yeah. And then we'll sing them a song or something on the radio. So what have you discovered in America that you wish your friends had in Singapore?
The food.
Food? Is that what you said?
Yes, the food.
All different kinds of food. Certainly tacos. Do you have tacos in Singapore?
I'm not too sure.
Okay. Do you have chili dogs?
No.
Have you had a chili dog yet?
No.
You haven't had a chili dog? Mr. Baseball, they haven't had a chili dog yet? I'll take you girls to one of the best places for chili dogs. What's the name of it again, Frank? No. Who's the king?
Manhattan.
No, who's the king of chili dogs in Des Moines?
Chili King?
George the Chili King. George the Chili King. You make sure your dad, or I'll come take you to George the Chili King. Best chili hot dogs you'll ever. You know what a hot dog is?
Yes.
Okay, so this is a hot dog in a bun smothered with chili. Do you like chili?
Yes.
And you like hot dogs?
Not really.
Not really.
Not really?
No.
How come?
I don't like the hot dog. I don't like the meat.
You don't like the meats? How about a chili hamburger? Have you had a hamburger?
Yes.
You like those?
No.
No, you don't like those either. How about pizza? Have you had pizza?
Yes.
Do you like it?
Yes.
Yes. So what's your favorite kind of chili? Oh no, I know. Here, we'll make you a chili dog pizza. Would you like that?
Taco pizza.
Bean burrito pizza. All right. One more thing you have to do before you go. Just say, Mommy, I love you.
Mommy, I love you.
Okay. These are the incredible twins. Andrea and Andrea just moved here from Singapore this last year, and I hope to hear much, much more from them. When we come back, Pastor David Harper in the house, and we're opening the vault. Yes, the vault. Ask the pastor questions. Are you ready? It's going to be fun. We're going to do it here with Bob Monserrat. And, of course, The Verse. Jill King's in the studio. So is Rob and Ryan. And we're coming back. I'm J. Michael McCoy. Thanks for listening. Love this job. Couldn't do it without you. Right here on The Truth.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios, this is Webcast One Live.
I'm Brian Leach, owner of Service Legends, and my position is Chief Talent Officer.
I'm Nicholas Wunderscheid.
I am Bernie Hobbs.
And I'm the Service Manager.
Marketing Director and Client Relations Manager.
Everything that we do is about ensuring that we exceed your expectations.
Our clients are important to us, 100% satisfaction.
We're not just focused on heating and cooling. That's the easiest part of our job, actually, is fixing furnaces and air conditioners.
Everyone that we come in touch with, we want to improve lives.
Bottom line is, we've got our installation guarantees, 25% energy savings guarantee, comfort guarantee, temperature selection guarantee, property protection guarantee.
100% satisfaction guaranteed, fixed rate or it's free.
All of those guarantees are backed up with a 100% money back guarantee to hold ourselves accountable to making sure that you get what you're after.
Just fixing the problem today. If they have another problem 5 days down the road, It's still fixed rate or it's free.
We use what's called straightforward pricing. Our technicians are going to give you an exact to the penny price on what it's going to take before they move forward with any repair. That way you know what to expect.
It's the same price every day.
No surprises.
If you get off work at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, you come home, you realize that, oh, my furnace is broken. Now you need to call somebody out that night. You shouldn't have to pay more for that.
We're guaranteeing service 24/7.
We run afternoons, evenings, nights, weekends. We're staffed to work that.
Phone rings at 3 in the morning. You'll get one of our representatives answering the phone every time.
We're not sending you out to Timbuktu in some call center. It's our service legend team members, our mission control team.
I'll take a call anytime.
And then they answer the phones the same way during the day as they do at night.
It's a great day at your service company. How can we make you smile?
That's the only way to provide true 24-hour service.
When you're able to let somebody actually live in their home safely when they weren't able to do that before, where they don't have to stay up at night and worry about, is the heat going to come back on? Are we going to freeze the pipes? Is the baby in the room next door going to be sick because they got too cold? When you're able to help somebody overcome challenges like that, that's impacting a life. That makes a difference. I get goosebumps thinking about it.
I love the team. I love the people that I work with.
We have fun, but we work hard.
I call them my ambassadors of legendary service. If you can just envision what that is, that's who we're sending to your home.
They literally will call in, pick up the phone and call and say, hey, I want to talk to your manager. And I get on the phone, they're like, that technician that was at my house was the greatest technician ever. That's cool to me.
We want to brighten people's days.
Every person that we have going into the house has gone through an extensive background check.
Drug testing. We have a very thorough interview process that 1 out of 140 people make it through.
If we promise you something, that's what you're going to get, no matter what.
We're here when you need us to protect the safety and comfort of your family.
If you're not happy, we're going to make it right.
If we're willing to put 100% money-back guarantee on what we do, what type of work do you think we do?
Give us a call. We're there for you 24/7, 365 days a year.
Enough said.
.438, 22 before the top, live here on The Truth, 99.3 KTIA. Salem Radio Network News at the top of the hour. Then Hank, the answer, the Bible answer man, will be on. Today, my special guest is David Harper, Pastor David Harper, and he is the chaplain with the Y. What do you do for the Y as a chaplain?
Most of what I do is counseling.
Okay.
We offer just free pastoral counseling to the staff, to members, and to the community. You don't even have to belong to the Y.
So you could just walk in and say, I want to see the chaplain, and then make an appointment with
you? Yes. And or call me and just make an appointment, and I'll see you in my office or out in the coffee shop or wherever.
That's got it. You got it. You have to see just a bizarre things.
I do. Yeah. There is a big, going from a pastor and
a church.
Yeah, counseling, pretty much the same things. But with the why, there are people, you know, who are not believers at all, who, you know, really come from distressed families. And so, yes, I see some really difficult things sometimes.
Frank?
What's the top question you're asked or subject matter that you're queried about?
As far as with counseling? Or
just people at the Y when they come to you, generally, what's
the first question is, what's the Y doing with a chaplain? Most people have no idea. The entire idea of the Young Men's Christian Association, for so many people, that just doesn't even, it's letters.
Well, I mean, would it be end of times, because there's so much focus today on end time events?
I bet it's not theological.
It's not theological at all. The why, within the why context, we're a Christian organization, but people don't look at the why like they do at church. So they're not asking me any kind of theological questions.
They come to you with addiction issues?
Addiction issues. Most of the issues I deal with revolve around divorce and the effects of divorce.
Wow.
I mean, I'm passionate about this. I know we were talking about the homosexual issue earlier. I'm sorry, divorce is way worse.
Way worse.
Is just the effects of that.
Yeah.
And I understand what happens and all like that, but the effects on people's lives, kids' lives, is just dramatic and terrible.
Destructive.
Yes.
All right, so Pastor David Harper, chaplain with the YMCA, first time here on the radio. Usually we do this at the beginning of the show, but we had other things to do. So I have a few questions.
Okay.
These are called Ask the Pastor questions.
All right.
In my mind, in Bob's mind, in Chris's mind, there are no wrong answers.
Okay.
I can't speak for Frank. There may be wrong answers in Frank's mind, and he'll let you know.
He'll let me know.
Yeah, he'll let you know. So first of all, here's an easy one. Are you the son of a risen king or a sinner?
I am the son of a risen king.
So you don't sin?
I sin, but the blood of Jesus covers me.
So you don't identify yourself as a sinner?
I've always had the idea, and this comes out of what was started here in Des Moines, Christ Life Solutions,
yeah.
Ultimate Journey. What you think about all day long and how you think about it, it's what you'll eventually become. And so if I focus on the sin part of it in my life, I think that leads me to continually beat myself up.
So you are what you behold?
Yes. You've got it. And so you keep your eye fixed on Jesus. And so that's how I would really describe myself.
So have you been through there are three phases in Christ's life?
I went through, my wife actually went through the original 3.5 years. I went through the 3 years and facilitated it for years and years.
Wow.
Yes.
So you know Jim Hobson.
Oh, yes. And I even though we don't do it at the Y, that is probably one of the most recommended things I recommend to people who come to me.
Cool. Have you ever been through the Truth Project?
No.
That'd be a good one for you to look into.
Okay.
It's about a 12, 14 week. It's really good. It's okay. Done by Focus on the Family.
Okay.
All right. Second question. Are you a spiritual being having a human experience or a human being having a spiritual experience?
Wow.
Are you a spiritual being having a human experience or a human being having a spiritual experience?
I guess I would have to come down on that I am a spiritual being having a human experience, that I am created. Who David Harper is a spirit.
Okay.
And he's his soul, his personality, and then it's housed in a body.
All right. Tell me if you agree with this next statement or not. Is tolerance the characteristic of a man with no convictions? Is tolerance the characteristic?
Depends on how you define tolerance. You define tolerance like we do today, or do you define tolerance with what it really means?
Well, what does it really mean?
Tolerance means we totally disagree, and we don't see eye to eye at all. We may even fight about it, but I will at least treat you with civility and respect.
And I have the right to be wrong in your mind.
Yes.
Okay.
You can be wrong, and that's all right. And I will continue to tell you you're wrong, and I think that's what tolerance allows me to do.
All right, next. Do you, David Harper, have a relationship with the accuser?
A relationship?
Yeah.
I would hope not. Not in the sense of he...
I didn't ask you if you hoped. Do you have a relationship with him or not?
No.
No.
I don't have... That one just totally throws me. Why would you even ask that?
Are you going to tell him he's wrong, Mac?
You're wrong. Because if you don't have a relationship with the accuser, then you don't sin. You don't sin through the relationship you have with your father or the Trinity.
The accuser doesn't make me sin.
He doesn't?
No.
Who makes you sin?
I do. When I'm drawn away by my own lust and desires, James Bingo. Chapter 1.
But where
right.
Do, choice. Where do those lusts and desires come from?
They come from myriad of things out there, from my own...
Temptation.
Well, yeah. But okay. I mean, who tempts me? Satan can tempt me.
Okay.
But that whole thing of I'm born with certain desires that you may not be born with.
Were you created to be sinful?
No.
Okay. Why are you sinful?
Only because of the fact that sin has so infected the world.
And where does sin come from?
Sin comes from my choice to refuse to follow God. Satan doesn't make me sin. Okay, Romans chapter 6 says, yeah. We have been freed from the power of sin.
You remember the contemporary comedian Flip Wilson?
Yes.
The devil made me do it. Did the devil make you do it, or did the devil tempt you to do it?
He tempted me to do it. And it, and not even the devil tempts me sometimes. Sometimes you tempt me to do it.
But you wouldn't sin if it wasn't for the accuser. You were created sinless.
No.
Because of him, you sin.
All right, then let me ask this question. If Satan died today and was not here tomorrow, would sin stop?
No. See, that's my whole thing. Satan has no power over the believer. He has no power. It's only when you allow him that power. Okay. Sin is not our master.
I can see that we're going to have this conversation again. Because you do have a relationship.
We need to tell Ed we need to spend an entire Tuesday month.
That's right. David and I are in a Bible study on Tuesdays at noon at the Y, and that's how I met him. But I'm telling you, you have a relationship with the accuser.
Mac's going to ask you if there's two wills or three.
Two wills or three?
You got God's will, right?
Yes.
And what else do we have?
We've got our will.
You have your own will?
Yes. Are you a Calvinist?
He's leaning way.
So in the old Tom and Jerry cartoons, when the little devil would appear on one shoulder and the angel on the other, you're telling me that you could put your arms out and hold back both of those wills and have a will of your own.
Yes.
Which would not be part of God's will and would not be a part of the accuser's will.
Yeah, I think I would say that.
Oh, man. Oh, man. Oh, man. All right. Last question. Real quick. All right. Let me find one. This will be a good one. Can you lose your salvation?
Yes, I think you can walk away from Jesus Christ.
You can abandon it.
You can abandon
it. So does Jesus go back and erase your name in the book of life then?
I think... at that point, you've trampled underfoot the blood of Christ. And so what he does, all I know is it says you've trampled underfoot, and it's a terrible thing to fall into the hands of a vengeful God.
We're coming back live here on The Truth. Wrong, 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 wrong.
Credit cards are like grandkids. They love you, sometimes get out of control, and it's fun to get a new one. Who can stop them from piling on?
Hi, I'm Tom Coates with Consumer Credit of Des Moines. At the end of the day, you can give these grandkids back, but you're stuck paying off bad credit card debt. We can help you put the fun back into using credit cards responsibly. Right, kids?
Yeah!
If you need help getting credit cards off your back, call Consumer Credit of Des Moines.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios, this is Webcast One Live.
Before the end of the show, I'm going to play you a video from a gospel group, country group by the name of Joey and Rory. I met them years and years and years and years ago and have stayed in touch with them. And their career did well. They got married, had a child. And a few years back in 2012, Joey was, she got cancer. And they've treated it and they've treated it and they've treated it. And we got the word this week that she's probably not going to survive the cancer. And so a young woman under the age of 40. We'll go home to Jesus, no doubt where she's going. But when she found out in 2012 she had cancer, she performed a song for her husband, Rory, called When I'm Gone. And we're going to play that song for you to wrap up the show today. And so that'll be the end of our show. Now, let's go back to Pastor David Harper, who has already proved that he's wrong several times.
Not that there's any right or wrong.
Do you?
But are you tolerant?
Am I tolerant of you being wrong?
Are you tolerant of me?
Oh, yes, of course.
Okay.
Yeah, of course, until 4:58:50, and then you're out of here. So do you believe in predestination?
I believe God predestined what people would become. In our study of Ephesians, he says he predestined us to become conformed to the image of his son.
Yes.
So I think God predestined what was to happen, but as far as... God said, Mac, yes, Frank,
the only
no.
problem I have with Calvinism...
Hold on, you don't agree with that. God
yeah,
said
that
yes.
I don't agree.
The only problem I have with Calvinism is the way they nuance the word all.
Right.
I don't know how you split a hair on the word all.
Right, right. I think
he conformed all to be... Or right. He predestined all to be conformed in the image
yes,
of God.
And that is it exactly. It's what is predestined was what we were to become.
So do you believe in limited atonement?
In the sense... What do you mean by limited atonement? You tell me what you think limited atonement means.
Was Jesus' blood shed for everybody?
Yes.
But not everybody will get it, will accept
it. But not everyone will. It's the whole thing of we say you're saved just because you believe. But we know that's wrong because Satan believes and the demons believe. There has to be an acceptance of something. That's what repentance. What we never hear anymore is repentance. And that's where you're making a choice.
To turn away.
Yes.
All right.
To turn away from my sin and follow him. Yes.
All right. So let's say that a man has a personal relationship with Jesus. Nobody else knows it. He doesn't go to church. He doesn't read his Bible. He never quotes scriptures. He doesn't tithe. From outside, nobody knows about that relationship with Jesus. Is he a Christian?
My question for that would be, why isn't the Spirit prompting him to do something?
Bob,
if he's a Christian, isn't the Spirit going to prompt him to do these things?
Bob, what's the name of this show?
Max World Live.
So who asks the questions? No, I
remember when
you.
Jesus was confronted by those Pharisees.
Yeah.
And they asked him the trick questions.
Yeah.
What do you always do?
It is written.
Made him mad.
Yeah.
In fact, they killed him.
They killed him. Now, yeah. I'm getting Frank, you're going to clear the way for me to get out of here when I leave. Right?
It is written.
Yes.
All right, is your church a cruise ship or a battleship?
Cruise ship or a battleship?
Yeah.
It's not a cruise ship.
Okay.
I don't like the term battleship.
You don't like that?
I don't like that term either. It's a fishing boat.
Is it the love boat?
Right. No, it's a fishing boat.
Last question. What Bible character reminds you of you?
My favorite character is Jeremiah.
And he reminds you of you?
Yes.
Okay. Why?
The passage where Jeremiah says, that's it, God, I'm not speaking anymore in your name. I'm done with this. And then he says, and when I say that, it becomes within me a burning fire and I can't keep it in. That has been me my whole life.
Pastor David Harper, Chaplain of the Y, thank you for being here today.
Thank
I want to
you.
Play you a song as we approach. This is from Joey and Rory. Joey at this moment is losing her life to cancer. Before it got her bad, she recorded this song for her husband called When I'm Gone. I want you to hear it today live in Max World.
A bright sunrise will contradict the heavy fall that weighs you down. In spite of all the funeral songs, the birds will make. their joyful sounds. You wonder why the earth still moves. You wonder how you'll carry on. But you'll be okay on that first day when I'm gone. Dusk will come with fireflies and whippoorwill and crickets call, and every star will take its place in silvery gown and purple shawl. You'll lie down in our big bed, dread the dark and dread the dawn. But you'll be all right on that first when I'm gone. You will reach for me in vain. You'll be whispering my name as if sorrow were your friend, and this so alien. But life will call with daffodils and morning glorious blue skies. You'll think of me some memory and softly when I'm gone.